guys, it's Holly here from PlayStation Access, and I have found Jake, and we're talking about Firewatch.
Yes.
You're like, yes, we are.
We are.
It looks incredible.
Oh, good.
But first of all, before we talk about Firewatch, Campo Santo.
Yes.
Now, you guys have there's some pedigree back there, especially with storytelling. Tell us a little bit about your background.
Okay, Campo Santo was started by me and my friend Sean Vanneman. We previously worked at Telltale Games, where we were the creative directors on Walking Dead Season 1. We left because we wanted to try doing our own thing, so we've partnered up with a bunch of people who are all kind of incredible, like dwarfing anything that any of us have ever done.
The resumes of like what your people have done is it's incredible.
Yeah, we've got an illustrator named Ollie Moss who's doing a lot of our art direction.
He
makes great stuff. You might know him from he did the box art to Resistance 3 as like an illustration that he did in games, but he's also done some Star Wars posters and some really just the beautiful illustration work. But we've got people on our team from who worked on Brutal Legend and The Cave at Double Fine, who worked on BioShock 2 and Mark of the Ninja, and a bunch of it's an incredible team working on this game that I'm really proud to be working with.
Let's talk about the story then. So it's set, the Yellowstone fires of 1988 took place.
Yes.
And this is set in 1989, I believe?
It's set in 89, yes, in the Shoshone Wilderness, which is the national forest right next to Yellowstone Park.
Okay. So what is the premise? So Henry is our lead guy?
Yes, you play as a man named Henry whose life kind of does not... He's had some bad times in his life.
Yeah.
And he decides that he's going to take a job working as a fire lookout, which is... it's a real job. You basically sit out in a little tower on stilts in the middle of the forest and watch outside. You have a beautiful 360-degree view, but your job is just if you see smoke... call it in, and then someone will send a helicopter or a firefighter out to deal with it. And that's really, in real life, your only job. It's apparently both very relaxing and boring, but we thought that it would be a very good setup for a sort of for a suspense story, for a mystery, because, you know, you're playing as a character who's out in the middle of nowhere with no human contact other than maybe your boss on the radio, and then what if something completely strange and wrong starts happening and the nearest other human being is days away from you? What do you do?
So how do you guys, when you're creating this game, how do you add that layer of tension then? Because it is just, you know, you have to be make the player feel alone.
Honestly, just making the outdoors feel real and the isolation, you know, feeling you just wander and wander and there's no one to talk to other than Delilah, your boss on the radio.
Yeah.
And after a while, it tends to just set in on its own.
Psychological.
Yeah, I mean, we've been living inside of Firewatch for almost 2 years now. But bringing it to PlayStation experience and seeing people on the floor playing it was a great reminder that there's actually stuff in this game that's creepy. Like, when you're developing it, you just stop kind of being worried about the scary parts. But, you know, we put players in the demo that we've got on the show floor. You go for a long, long, long time without seeing a person. And then suddenly, when you finally see another human being and it's just a silhouetted figure up on a hill that shines a flashlight in your face, it's a reminder that, oh, maybe I'm not as alone as I thought. And I think that goes a long way towards spooking people out.
Now, you said creepy, but you haven't said horror. Would you not describe this as horror then?
We're kind of calling it a mystery thriller more than horror.
Yeah.
So it's not. It's more sort of the slow burn and sort of the slow twisting tension more than like, you know, like Slender Man's not going to come popping out or whatever.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
So yeah.
Now, the walkie-talkie obviously seems absolutely key to this. It's your connection to the outside world. It's your connection to making sense of what's happened.
Mm-hmm.
How did you guys come up with that idea of that being the hook? Because I know you guys, someone in your team worked on Bioshock 2, but you guys said in the past it was slightly inspired by your like relationship with Atlas, which was really quite sinister.
Yeah, it's kind of a combination of Sean and my experience and a few other people on the team making adventure games, making games where sort of characters and dialogue and story are really important. And then also a lot of the first-person games that we loved, including Bioshock, which various Bioshock games our team has worked on. A lot of, like, if you think of Portal, Portal 2, the Bioshock games, System Shock 2.
You really are just listing off, like, all the incredible games.
A lot of one of the standout things about those games is that character who's with you the entire time, who's always a voice in your ear. And in those games, often it's a villain who makes fun of you and stuff, or talks down to you and sort of makes your life terrible. But we sort of we thought it would be interesting to make a game where you can talk back to that person, where the game was actually about the conversation with that person as you were playing the first person experience.
Now I'd like to give community watchers some idea of the depth of this game, because it's okay. A massive like open world, run around, do what you want. But when Nathan was playing, he found a bunch of like teenagers and a walkie-talkie, and they were like mad at him, so he picked up their walkie-talkie, threw it in the lake, and then they were even more mad at him that he had done that. And he was like, I didn't realize that I could just. Sounds daft, but you could just do something that simple because it's very non-scripted.
Right. We want players to be able to totally screw around. I mean, when you say open world, that gets a little bit. It's not quite like we're not. This is not like a Bethesda game or something. It's a very story-first experience. But we definitely want players to be able to screw around, to be able to find things, and to be able to sort of feel like as they're playing it, it is they're sort of helping to tell the story along with us. So there is. A mystery, and there's this relationship with Delilah that you're building over the course of the game, but we want you to feel like you are in this chunk of the wilderness in the out of doors, and if you think that there's something that you should be able to do, we want to let you do it as much as we possibly can. So yeah, you know, even though this demo that we've been showing and the is asking players to do one or two very specific things, it's been really fun to see at the show to see people, like, there's an old haunted abandoned lookout tower out in the world that people have found, and there's like a few weird encounters with a raccoon that I've watched some people see, and like some people instead of throwing the radio in the lake have just stolen it and like jammed out of there with it, and like it all works, and we put a lot of work into making sure the game is responsive to that sort of stuff, and it's been really fun to watch people actually do all of it.
Now dialogue obviously is really important then if you're alone and you have Delilah and that's that conversation that you're having. Talk about your voice actors. I know Rich, obviously. I'm a massive fan of Devil Wears Prada.
Okay.
And he was in that. But how do you find your voice actors and create that dialogue you're going to need?
Sissy Jones, who voices Delilah, she played the character of Katya in The Walking Dead Season 1, and we actually had hoped that we could cast her from the beginning when we came up with this game. Rich Sommer, who, he is in Devil Wears Prada, but I think a lot of people know him from Mad Men as Harry Crane, the TV guy. We actually ended up meeting Rich because he is a big board game and tabletop gaming geek.
No way.
And one of our programmers, Patrick, runs a board gaming mailing list, and it turned out that Rich followed that on Twitter, so we were able to send him a DM over Twitter and ask if he was interested in being in it.
Seriously?
And then it turned out he had played Walking Dead, so it was just a total, like, extreme geek internet connection weird thing that we, like, he'd been on the list of actors who our character was kind of inspired by, so having him be interested in doing it was awesome.
That's really cool. Okay, now very finally, just finish by telling the community when can they actually play, because you guys do have a release date.
Yes, we're coming out February 9th, 2016.
So it's not that long.
No, it's not.
He says it's really not.
It is very soon.
Oh my God. Thank you so much for talking to us.
Sure.
Nathan is absolutely in love with this. We're really hoping to have some gameplay stuff on the channel soon.
Great.
Thank you so much. You guys can stay tuned to my YouTube channel, and if you're one of the lucky countries, you can download the PlayStation Access app on your PlayStation 4 and watch all our videos on there.